very respected personalities from different spheres of life and leaders on the stage, my very dear brothers and sisters, Sahodari Sahodara Gale, I would like to congratulate the organizers of this meeting, the Tamil Nadu Platform for People's Unity, to bring us all together to discuss a very important issue of Kashmir in the context of the Constitution of India and the democratic framework of India. It is very important to have such platforms to develop people's unity, because I believe that in a situation where the Constitution of India is under challenge, not from external forces, but by the elected central government of India, it is only the people, people's unity, and people's strength and their belief in the basic values of our Constitution and our democratic framework that India can be saved. We are seeing right-wing mobilizations across the world. We are seeing the destruction of human values. We are seeing the growth of extreme rightist forces, xenophobic forces, racist forces, fascist or neo-fascist forces. And tragically and unfortunately, we see their dark shadow growing over our beloved India. And therefore, when the challenge to the soul of a country comes from its own elected government, then the crisis has a different dimension which can be met not only in the narrow realm of political parties. Of course, the role of political parties is essential and crucial. But when we are facing a challenge of the kind that we face in India today, it is important for each and every citizen of India to stand up and be counted and to say, we are Indians, and we are Indians who believe in the values of secularism, democracy, and equality. And therefore, a people's platform for people's unity is an appropriate platform which I believe should be replicated in different parts of India. So I really congratulate the platform for this initiative. I hope you get strengthened in the days to come. My dear friends, I'm also glad that we are discussing the issue of Kashmir in the context of the Constitution, in the context of democracy. Because we know the very concept of democracy is indivisible. You cannot have democracy for some and the destruction of human rights for another section of the population. Because if any section of the population is deprived of their democratic rights, that is a reflection on democracy itself. So I think the first lesson we have to take from Kashmir is for us to understand that the Modi government, in his diabolical move to destroy the democratic rights of one section of Indian citizens, is precisely trying to promote the concept that democracy can be divided. And we citizens of India have to assert democracy cannot be divided. If a single Kashmiri child is put into jail, if a single Kashmiri woman is denied her right to health because every single street corner of Kashmir is guarded by barbed wires and you require a special license to go to the hospital, if that happens, then my dear friends, we are not talking about democracy. As my friend here said, we are not talking about accession. We are talking about the occupation without democracy of some sections of Indian citizens. A string of lies is there about Kashmir. And very briefly, I want to take up each and every one of them. But before I do so, I want to stress why I believe democracy is indivisible. I'm sure you all know, the news came this morning that a day or two ago in Wardha University, six students of Wardha University have been expelled, summarily expelled from the university. Why? The students were organizing a protest in solidarity with the 49 intellectuals and eminent personalities who had been charged with sedition. So the students decided that they too will write letters to the Prime Minister expressing their concern over mob lynching incidents and about false cases put against anybody who dissents or criticizes this government. And that letter was addressed to the Prime Minister of India. So a batch of students writing a letter to the Prime Minister of India, not the Prime Minister of Pakistan, not the opposition leader of Britain, the Prime Minister of India. And the punishment for the students for writing a letter to our own Prime Minister is expulsion from Wardha University. This is a shameful incident. We must condemn it in the strongest words. Just as the sedition case against 49 intellectuals has been withdrawn under public pressure, as one of my friends has stated very correctly. When citizens' voices are raised, this is not an aberration that some chief judicial magistrate in the Muzaffarpur court of Bihar should accept such a bogus complaint and act on it. I don't want to cast aspersions on that judge, but certainly as thinking citizens, we wonder, what are these standards? That is the same district where in the hostel there were children who had been repeatedly raped. Are these people not aware of social realities? Could they not have taken suo motu notice of such incidents? But they do not. But immediately a petition comes on a bogus complaint on against dissent, and a CGM immediately accepts it and orders the police to take action. I say the judiciary also has to come under scrutiny. That is also part of our democracy. We cannot shut our eyes and say we believe in the rule of law, when those who are the guardians of the rule of law, the government, the police, and the judiciary, when they behave in a way which challenges democratic sense, then definitely we have to say we do not believe in this rule of law, because this is not the rule of law, this is the rule of lawlessness. Therefore, this suspension or expulsion of these six students of Wardha University is part of this attack on democracy. So when we talk about the students of Kashmir not being able to go to school, not being able to go to college, not being able to pursue their education, not being able to give their exams, being deprived of the right to education. It is not just in Kashmir, it happens in other parts of India also, because the attack on Kashmir is not just on Kashmir, the attack on Kashmir is on all citizens of India and democratic institutions and processes of India. So I hope you will join me in strongly condemning the action against those six students of Wardha University, and you will raise the demand that that expulsion order should be immediately withdrawn. Now, if we look at Kashmir, and if we look at the processes and what the propaganda is, the first point is that we are told that everything in Kashmir is normal. That is the first big lie. Nothing in Kashmir is normal. Last week, we had a central committee meeting of my party in Delhi. One of the members of the central committee is a leader of Kashmir, Comrade Yusuf Tarigami. You know that our general secretary had to go to the Supreme Court, Comrade Sitaram Yechuri, to ask them in a habeas corpus petition to produce Yusuf Tarigami, because we did not know his whereabouts. Twice a delegation had gone, led by a general secretary, but they could not meet Yusuf Tarigami. So we said, bring him. But in a strange interpretation of the habeas corpus, they said, no, we will not produce him, you go to Kashmir. So we went to Kashmir, met him. The case was in the Supreme Court. 10 days before, in the Supreme Court, the government council was asked as part of that petition that what is the status of Yusuf Tarigami? Has he been charged with any, under any law? They said, no, no, he is free to come and go, there is no charge of any law. And yet, when he went back to Kashmir, he was immediately put under house arrest. Here in Delhi, in the Supreme Court, they are saying he's not under house arrest. He wrote a letter to the district magistrate seeking permission to attend the central committee meeting of the CPIM. This is a nationally recognized party. What happened? The district magistrate refused to give the permission. He could not attend the meeting. And the same day, Mr. Amit Shah was giving lectures in Maharashtra saying, everything is normal in Kashmir, the abnormalcy is only in the minds of the opposition. So what is abnormal is the continued efforts of the government of India, led by Narendra Modi, Amit Shah and their colleagues, to try and tell the world that Kashmir is normal. And when we as Indian citizens say, no, Kashmir is not normal, Kashmir cannot be normal, when the entire mainstream leadership of Kashmir is in jail, it cannot be normal, then we are told, you are anti-national, you are dissidents. So the first lies, Kashmir is normal. No, it is not normal. It is under lockdown. Communications are restricted. The leadership and the political activity is restricted. And the biggest farce being enacted in Kashmir today is the so-called board elections, the BDC elections. How can you hold BDC elections when the electoral college for the BDC election is the Panch and Sarpanch? 61% of the Sarpanch and Panch seats are vacant today. There was no election in December. It is vacant. You are not allowing any political activity. In such a situation, you want to hold elections to capture the BDCs and then to use that to tell the world everything is normal. So this normalcy is a normalcy which subverts democracy, it subverts parliamentary democracy, and more importantly, it puts all those leaders in jail who believe in secularism, who have participated in parliamentary democracy, and many of whom, like Yusuf Tarigame, have faced attacks not once, not twice, but several times from militants backed by those across the border. So the first lie of Modi and Amit Shah, that Kashmir is normal, is challenged by everyday experience of Kashmir. The second big lie is that now we have integrated Kashmir with the rest of the country. 370 had prevented the integration of Kashmir with India. This is a total lie. What is the historical reality? Some of my friends have spoken about it. I don't want to repeat what you have already heard. But where is the lie? The lie is that those today who are talking about the integration of Kashmir with the rest of the country, please ask them, where were they in the early 1940s when the people of entire Kashmir in undivided India before partition, when the people of Kashmir rose in revolt against the repressive feudal monarchy which was existent at that time in Kashmir. It was a monarchy, it was a feudal monarchy, when one third of the resources of Kashmir was taken by the monarch, Hari Singh and his family. I'm not going into those details. But at that time, the RSS in Kashmir was working under the name of the Praja Parishad. And at that time, when the people of Kashmir were fighting feudalism, when they were fighting oppression, when the slogan in Kashmir was British quit India, Maharaja quit Kashmir, that was a slogan at that time. Where was the RSS? Where was the Praja Parishad? It was not with the people of Kashmir. It was not with the democratic aspirations of the people of Kashmir. They were standing with the monarchy. And in 1947, when the popular movement was strong, please remember, when the rest of the principalities and the monarchies in the rest of India, the princely states in the rest of India, when they were acceding to India, at that time, it was Kashmir under the Maharaja of Kashmir who stated publicly and gave a letter to then Governor General Mountbatten and said, we have the letter here. He said, it is better to wait and see, because it may be in the interests of Kashmir to stay independent from both Pakistan and from India. It was not the people of Kashmir. It was the Maharaja of Kashmir. And during that entire period, it was the Praja Parishad which stood by the Maharaja and agreed, because they were pro-monarchy, they were pro-feudal. What is happening in Nepal today? Who is supporting the monarchy or the remnants of the monarchy in Nepal? It is precisely the RSS and its supporters who have been intervening in Nepal and supporting the pro-monarchy forces in the name of a Hindu kingdom. So that was the understanding. So on the one hand, you had the people of Kashmir, predominantly the majority of whom belong to the Muslim community, along with all other communities, fighting for what? Fighting for Kashmir to be part of India. It was not, as Amit Shah and Narendra Modi say today, that there was no integration of Kashmir with India. It is a straight lie. It is the people of Kashmir who rose in revolt when Pakistan sent armed raiders, because Pakistan was formed on the basis of religion. It believed in the basis of a religious state. And it was on that basis that they could not tolerate to see that a Muslim majority state should opt not to go with a theocratic state of Pakistan, but to choose to stay with an India which promised democracy, an India which promised pluralism, an India which affirmed that it would protect the rights of different peoples, of different groups. It was that. That was the history. And at that time, it was the people, it was the Muslims of Kashmir who fought back the Pakistan invaders, while Maharaja Hari Singh and all his nobles ran to Jammu for protection. Please remember, it was those in the valley today, it was the forefathers of those in the valley today who, under the leadership of the then National Conference led by Sheikh Abdullah, fought back until the Indian Army was sent and until Maharaja Hari Singh was forced to sign the instrument of accession. How can we forget our history? Those who have always been against people's unity, those who first proposed the two-nation theory. It was Veer Savarkar who first proposed the two-nation theory much before Muhammad Jinnah did. Years before that. And once again at the time of Kashmir, it was they who said, "Are, let the Muslims who are there, let them go to Pakistan if they want to." And they supported the Maharaja's call for an independent Kashmir. And today, when that article of the Constitution, the third big lie, was Vallabhbhai Patel, Shama Prasad Mukherjee, those were the great leaders who were against what happened. That is another big lie. The first meeting which was held before Section 370 was drafted was held in the house of Vallabhbhai Patel, and the first meeting was attended by Abdullah Nehru. These are facts of history. Shama Prasad Mukherjee was a member of the cabinet at that time. And it is they who accepted and passed 370. And they accepted a constitution of Kashmir. They accepted that on certain rights, there will be a constitution of Kashmir. Now we hear from Amit Shah and Modi and all the RSS BJP, the third big lie, that Kashmir constitution was against the constitution of India. I've never heard such a big lie. The constitution of Kashmir, which was there, in its very basis was a secular constitution. And why was it required? Two main reasons. One, the issue of land reform. The National Conference and the political forces at that time, the freedom fighters, they had promised the people of Kashmir, when India becomes independent, you will have your own land. We will get rid of the big landlords. We will get rid of the big zamindars. So much before the issue of land reform became central to Indian politics, it was the constitution of Kashmir which did not give protection in its constitution, and they took over land without compensation, and that was one of the greatest contributions of what that constitution did for the people of Kashmir. When was the abolition of the purses, princely purses. It was much later. But under the Constitution of Kashmir, they abolished all the special privileges of the Maharaja. And the third most important point, Article 3 of that Constitution, in very clear, unambiguous terms stated, Kashmir is an integral part of India. What lies are these people saying? That constitution which they have now got rid of, that is the constitution which for so many years bound the people of Kashmir to India because it was in their own constitution passed by their own constituent assembly, which said Kashmir is an integral part of India. Now they say the fourth big lie. No, how can there be such things? How can there be such differences? As our friend here has very correctly said, Article 3, it is followed by Article 371. It is followed by Article 371 A to I. And in all those articles, 371 A, B, C, D up to I, there are special provisions for states. Today you cannot buy land in Himachal Pradesh, you are not allowed to. Today you cannot go to Manipur without an inner line permit. Today for Nagaland, the government of India is negotiating with a group which is a declared group which had wanted and worked for a separate Nagaland country. You are negotiating with them, not in India, on foreign soil. And you are promising them a Naga Accord. And those leaders have stated in no unambiguous terms that we are discussing our own flag, our own constitution with the government of India. It is not Indian opposition in parliament. It is that group of Nagaland negotiating with Mr. Modi's representative who said, we are negotiating a separate flag and constitution for Nagaland. Why they are keeping the Naga Accord secret? Why? Naga people don't know what the accord is. So, it is essential, that is the nature of our constitution, to recognize unity in diversity. Not Hindi hamara rashtra bhasha hai. Modi ji can wear a veshti and angasram and wander around the beaches of Chennai. We don't mind. He can go to Bengal and wear a dhuti Punjabi. That also we don't mind. He can also go somewhere else and wear the Naga, what is that? That beautiful cap and shawl that they wear. All that can be done. He looks very beautiful in fancy dress. No problem about it. But the point is, unless you understand diversity means affirmative action for different sections of the people, unless you understand the history of our country, the history of pluralist cultures, unless you understand that, you can wear any dress you like, but if your heart is the RSS heart of Nagpur, you can never serve the interests of it. Another big lie. 370 has led to terrorism. What is he talking about? Was there 370 in Punjab when the Khalistani terrorists created so many acts of violence? Was there 370 in the whole of the Northeast when so many political militant groups were born and fought and used arms? These are political circumstances. These are political reasons. There are grave feelings of injustice. Unless you deal with a political problem with a political resolution, you cannot hope to overcome the danger of terrorist activity. Yes, in Kashmir, there is no doubt that they have got aid from the beginning, from the Pakistani establishment, from the Pakistani military. That is a fact. There is no denying the dangers and the continuing efforts of cross-border terrorism. But cross-border terrorism is fought back through people's unity. The danger arises when those who encourage cross-border terrorism find a resonance among the people of that country, against the people, on the people of the state, when local militants grow. Local militants grow only when there is a conducive atmosphere for local militancy to grow, which grows because of the denial of democracy and the use of repression to put an end to political questions. You cannot deal with a political question on the basis of the barrel of a gun. You cannot deal with the Kashmir problem looking at Kashmir as a piece of territory and not looking at the needs and requirements of the people of Kashmir. And what the BJP RSS has done, an assault on the Constitution of India. I ask you, suppose tomorrow somebody came and said, we are dividing Tamil Nadu. Suppose somebody came and said, without reference to you, to your voice, to your opinion, to your rights, to the rights of your elected MLAs and MPs. Supposing somebody told you, from tomorrow your state is divided. How would you react? Article 3 of the Constitution of India guarantees any change in any territorial dispute has to be done through discussion and through the resolution of the state assemblies concerned. Here, what did they do? They dissolved the state assembly. They brought it under president's rule. And under president's rule, they subverted the right of the people of Kashmir to be heard. They replaced the state assembly with the governor and said the governor represents the people of Kashmir. So the substance of it, the method of it, the procedure that was adopted on all fronts, this is a grave assault on democracy and on the constitutional provisions which ensure the structure of federalism remains in India. Without federalism, my friend was talking about regional identities. Those identities are protected because we have adopted a federal structure. Today, it is the principle of federalism which is under severe assault. Every state which is ruled by a non-BJP government, even BJP governments, but they don't dare speak. But every state knows today what is its fate under this Modi government. What are the resources that a state government has to fulfill its election pledges to the people? What are the rights a state has to protect its culture, its identity, its language? These are basic issues, my dear friends, which concern every citizen of India. And the last point I would like to make is, it is not just Kashmir. We know they want to change the demography of Kashmir. They want to do what Israel has done in Palestine. But it is not just that. What is today being attempted is to change the very basis of who constitutes a citizen of India. Our constitution says, was born in India as a citizen of India. Today we have the Citizenship Amendment Bill. The Citizenship Amendment Bill is the first step of the RSS BJP Sangh Parivar to change the basis of who is a citizen of India. If you say today that anybody except a Muslim who comes from another country can be given the rights of citizenship of this country, then what are you doing? You are changing the basis of citizenship from universal rights to a right identified only through religion. You are making different classes of citizens. We already know we have the toxic caste system in India. We already know that even though the constitution grants equal rights to Dalits and tribals, there is no issue here of equal rights. And today we hear the RSS leaders say, let us have a debate on reservation. What does it mean? It means they are against reservation. They are against equality, granted, because of the historical burden of injustice, oppression, indignity, which has been visited on Dalit communities and Adivasi communities, which still exists in different forms in India today. And now they want to make a second-class citizen of Muslims of India. Those of you who have been to Assam or who have heard of Assam and what is being faced, Tamil Nadu is far from the northeast. You did not have the same issues that many other states had when refugees had come or when populations had come across the borders. So that experience is specific to regions. But what happened? Those who have lived in Assam for decades, today, those citizens are terrified. They are terrified because the burden of proof is on them to show that they are citizens of India. Poor people, do they have documents? When there are floods in Bihar and when everything in a house is destroyed and a poor family, a Dalit family or an agricultural worker family loses their Aadhaar card, we know that they are denied rations because they don't have an Aadhaar card. It's a reality. Documents are fragile, we know. 23 lakh Adivasi families are facing eviction from the forests of India because they do not have documentary proof. How will they have documentary proof? Where will they get the documentary proof? But today, a whole set of citizens identified as belonging to a particular minority community, their citizenship is in question. They are being called termites. They are being called infiltrators. They are being demeaned. Don't think that this is against one community. It is against one community, but it has much wider implications, my dear friends. And therefore, the issue of Kashmir has to be seen in the context of many other developments that are taking place. We don't have the time today in this particular meeting to discuss the elimination of the democratic rights of workers, of peasants, of what is happening in the economy, which is in a recession. There is no denying it. And today the government of India is in a state of deliberate denial. They don't want to talk about it. Because if they talk about it, the castle of cards that they have built and behind which they hide to cheat the people of India, that castle of cards will collapse. And therefore they talk about so many diversionary issues which divide us, which weaken us. And in dividing and weakening us, they divide India. They weaken India. And therefore, My friend was absolutely right when he said, they are not patriots. They are not those who believe in the strength of India, because the strength of India lies in our diversity, in our pluralism, in our respect for each other, not in the hate and toxic communal politics driven by corporate money that the BJP RSS represents. So let us all remember that the people of Kashmir are our brothers and sisters. What is happening to them affects each of us in a much deeper way than is apparent today. I thank you once again for giving me this opportunity to come and meet you.